Dear brothers and sisters, many people all around the globe pray to God in one manner or another. The prayers might be asking for some material gains for themselves, maybe for some help, for the health of a loved one to be better, maybe some blessings for their children or their family or friends. And what is very interesting is that when we look at how people pray in many, many different ways. People pray in different languages. People have different positions of the body in which they pray. But there is a commonality in their prayer and the reason for which they are praying. They are all praying to God in one manner or another. They are praying for a blessing to be coming to them. They pray with a lot of love in their hearts and with a lot of respect for God. And as we start to look at what these prayers are for, and we start to think about where people go and pray, something very interesting comes out. You know, when we look back at religions and we look back at spirituality in the spiritual way, we know that many teaching stories have been told in many traditions. Teaching stories so that spiritual truths can be remembered by us. Now, these stories are imaginary, but they leave us with guidance, with truth, with something to hang on to as we pass through life. So I'd like to relate a teaching story which would be helpful to us to understand what the true purpose of prayer is. We pray generally for one object or another, but what should we be praying for? Saints and mystics have been telling us that we should always pray for God. We should not ask God for what we want. We should let God play out in our lives what is right for us. Sant Rajinder Singh Maharaj, who wrote much about the spiritual path, he talks about prayer in the following manner. He says, "Nahi janta ki main kya tujhse mangu." नहीं जानता कि मैं क्या तुझसे मांगूं जो मेरे लिए है भला चाहता हूं. So he is praying to God. He says, "Oh God, I don't know what I should ask you for. So please give me whatever you think is good for me, whatever will be taking me towards my goal, whatever is right for me." And that's the kind of prayer that we should be having towards God. Now, this teaching story is imaginary, as most teaching stories are. In this story, we are told that there was a bunch of people who were just traveling on a road. And as they were traveling on the road, they passed through the town and they came to an area which was an open field. And as they're talking to each other and they're walking on this road, far away on one of the sides, they see that on a rock, some person is sitting. So they talk to each other. They say, "Who could be sitting in this area? This is like a lonely area. There's no one else around here. Maybe the person needs some help." So they start to go in that direction. As they get closer, lo and behold, they were shocked. They saw God sitting on the rock. So they paid their obeisance. And once they were done with their obeisance, they ask God a question. They say, God, what are you doing in this lonely place? So God said, I don't want to tell you my problems. And they said, God, you can tell us your problems. We know you can do everything. But maybe, you know, sometimes you just talk about a problem and you feel good. We'll be happy to listen to your problems. So God says, oh, I have a few complaints. So they said, God, you have complaints? And God said, yes, yes, I have complaints. So they said, you know, what are your complaints, God? So God said, you know, I'm very lonely. And they said, God, you're very lonely. You created everything and everything is yours. How can you be lonely? And God says, not only am I lonely, but I've been kicked out of my house. Now they get worried. They say, God, who kicked you out of your house? And how can someone kick you out of your house? So God said, not only from my one house, I got kicked out from many, many of my houses. Now the people get more worried. And they ask God, please, can you explain to us how you can be lonely and be kicked out of your house? God said, you know, I'm homeless now in many, many of my homes. And now they're wondering what is happening. And so they plead to God to explain to them so they could maybe understand and see if they can help in some manner. So God said, you know, I reside in every human being. And instead of human beings trying to find me through the divine light and sound, which are my two primary manifestations, you know what they've done? They have taken me and put me in different places. So they don't look for me where I reside, which is their own selves. They look for me in places built of mortar which they build themselves. And not only that, God said, people took me out of my home and put me in different forms where they limited me. So sometimes they make a face with a big beard, sometimes they make a face which is dark, sometimes they make a face which is one way, sometimes they make a face which is another way. And not only that, then when they go there, instead of them trying to be with the divine light and sound, which I am, in the places of worship, they try to look for me with external light. They might light candles, they might light diyas, they might turn bulbs on, and also they try to pray to me through external sounds, ringing bells or doing other sounds in the places of worship. So in the meantime, I am lonely because no one is coming to where I am. So then I decided I better get out of here too, because no one's coming to meet me. And this is why I'm sitting here and I'm pondering how to solve this situation. So people said, God, we want you back in your own home. And God said, you know, everyone says they want me back in the home, but no one comes to visit me there. And here I am, I've been in the home of each human being for eons and eons. And I wait there and I wait there and wait there, and hardly anyone shows up. And all they're interested in is going to places which are far away from where they live. They want to go to places which are more difficult to get to. They want to go to places which they have built themselves. and they are looking for me in those places, and not realizing that all they have to do is to take their attention when they are put out into the world and just come within. And so these travelers are saying, God, we don't want to keep you lonely. We want you to be happy. Actually, we want to be with you. And this is why we pray to you. And the purpose of prayer, even though we pray for just objects of this world, or for someone to be feeling better, or someone to get married, or someone to have a child, or some other object that either we would want, or our children would want, or some one of our loved ones would want, our main purpose is to commune with you, to talk to you, to see you, and to be with you. And God said, if you really want to be with me, I'm there with you. All you have to do is to focus within yourself. And so these people said, God, we are definitely going to do that. And we want to be sure that you're not lonely, and we're going to make sure that we are with you so that you have some company. God said, I know this is not going to happen, because people have been saying that for eons and eons. And there's very, very few who do that. But I want all of you to be communing with me. I want all of you to be out of the wheel of transmigration. I want all of you to be fulfilling the very purpose for which you have come into this world. And God said, you know, I'm going to sit in the special place within each one of you. And this place is here, between and behind the two eyebrows. And I'm going to be there. And as soon as you invert there, I would be so happy to meet with you. And so they promise that as soon as they get back home, they're going to be visiting God, and they left. So God went and resided in each one of the human beings again. And then God waited for the human beings to turn within and meet with them. So one day passed, another day passed, another day passed, another day passed. And many days passed and no one showed up. So God peeps through God's own vision and sees what's going on. And there he sees all the people. They get up in the morning. Most of them take a shower. Many of them brush their teeth. They have breakfast and they go out. Some work for some other people. Some are running businesses. Some are traveling. And so they spend the whole day in doing whatever chores they are doing, for which they get some money so they can survive. They come back home and then they relax, have dinner, and do whatever chores they have to do for the house, and they go to bed. And the next day they're doing the same thing and the same thing and same thing. And this is what is happening with most of us. You know, we've all been sent here to know God. We are the lucky souls who have received this human existence. And this human existence is called the roof and crown of all creation, because in this existence, God has given us all the faculties that are required by us to know God. Now, God has been very gracious and has given us these faculties. God has been very gracious and has given us this human existence. Now, we need to make use of this existence and all the faculties which are coming with this existence. But what are we doing? We are searching for God, sometimes by going here, sometimes by going here, Sometimes we're going there. We are finding out about God by reading about God. Our situation is like that of a mother. You know, mothers love their children tremendously. If a mother, in her love for the child, only is thinking about the clothes of the child, she's only thinking about the toys that the child has, if she's only reading about how to bring children up, but she never meets the child, she's never going to be happy. Unless the mother meets the child, she is never truly, truly happy. It's the same thing with us. We, whose real existence is not at the level of the body, but at the level of the soul. Our sole purpose of being in the human body is to meet with God, to get off the wheel of transmigration. But instead, if we only read about God, if we only do our rites and rituals, if we just find out what the qualities of God, but we never meet God, then this existence that we have been given would be wasted. Many saints and mystics have talked about this. Kabir Sahib has said very beautifully, he says, Moko kahan dhunde re bande, main to tere paas hoon. Kabir Sahib is saying, oh, you human being, where are you searching? Because he realizes that the human being is searching here and searching there and searching there and searching for God in all kinds of activities of the world outside. We have our rites and rituals, we have our ways of praying, we go to our places of pilgrimages because we feel that's the right thing to find God. And so we're doing all these outer things. And Kabir Sahib is saying, where are you searching for me, O human being? I am within you. I am with you. I am closer to you than anything else. You need to invert. And that's what we all need to do too. If our attention is only in the world outside, if we think we can find God by reading something about God, by hearing something about God, by lighting up some candles or ringing some bells or doing all kinds of other rites and rituals that we do, then look at the lives of the great saints and mystics, the lives of those after whom great religions of the world have been founded. They all had communion with God, but they had it in silence. They didn't have a communion when they went to a place of worship someplace. They didn't have communion with God when they maybe were doing some rites and rituals. They had communion with God when they sat in silence. And it was in the silence of the body and the silence of the mind that the revelations of God came to them and their communion with God truly happened. So we also need to focus on that aspect of our faiths, which is the esoteric side of our faith, which is the inner side of our faith, which deals with the soul, the spirit, the flights of the soul, which deals with consciousness much higher than the physical consciousness of us. You know, we don't need to rise up and reach different parts of this world to be able to know God. What we need to do is have a soul rise up and soar into the inner spiritual regions. That's what the saints and mystics have been telling us. They all went on a spiritual journey, a journey of love and a journey of light, a journey that starts with the process called meditation or inversion. Meditation is taking our attention away from the world outside and focusing it within ourselves, so that we can collect our sensory currents within ourselves at the seat of the soul, and then with help and guidance we can soar into the inner spiritual regions and have a meeting with the Creator. So let us remember this teaching story. Even though it's imaginary, if we remember it, we will know that God needs us to be with God. God wants us to be with God. God loves us tremendously. God doesn't want us to be caught up in this wheel of transmigration. God wants us to be joyous, happy, and peaceful for all times to come, eternally. And this is an opportunity that God has given us to get to that state. So let's make the best use of this opportunity of being in this human existence. And let us meditate. Let us connect with the true lights which are within ourselves. Let us listen to the true celestial music which God created as creation was brought into being by the Creator. And as we connect with this divine light and sound of God, then the creative power which brought all creation to being will also take our soul back to our true home in the lap of God, where we can be one with the Creator. So let us meditate for a few minutes. Please sit as comfortably as you can. Close your eyes very gently, making sure the eyeballs are straight, focused 8 or 10 inches in front of you. As you close your eyes, those of you who have been initiated in the mysteries of the beyond, please do your simran. Those of you who are new here, please repeat any name of God that you feel comfortable with. This repetition of God's name should be done mentally and not out loud. I pray to God Almighty to help each and every one of us here. And it's my prayer to the three great spiritual masters of the past century, Hazur Baba Savan Singh Ji Maharaj, Param Sant Kripal Singh Ji Maharaj, and Dayal Purush Sandarshan Singh Ji Maharaj, to help each and every one of us here connect with the divine power within and to experience the divine light in its effulgence. We'll be sitting for a few minutes. I'll be getting you out of this meditative state at that time. And my best wishes are with each and every one of you. Please leave off, Chordi Jeji.